Inescapable. One of the things that make action movies action is that the hero or the heroine, I tried to make two words out of that into one, the hero or the heroine gets themselves into what? Seemingly inescapable situations, right? But they get out of them. That's why they're the hero and the heroine. Now, I grew up, of course, watching Sunday cartoons, and inevitably, I was always intrigued by the coyote and the roadrunner. Because inevitably, the roadrunner was going to win. It was inescapable. He always won. And poor coyote ended up doing things that no one would ever survive. But that's what makes action movies action. I don't know how many of you here are science fiction fans. Some of you may be. Some of the new science fiction is, we'll leave that there. But Edgar Rice Burroughs, who's famous for writing what? Tarzan wrote the John Carter of Mars series, which was one of the first of a syndicated science fiction. And John Carter, who was an Earthman who then goes to Mars, Barsoom, was always in some inescapable situation, whether it was large numbers in armies or whether he was trapped in a dungeon that's being flooded, and it seemed inescapable. But what did John Carter do? He did. I'm going to read two passages of Scripture, and I want you to consider them as we come in preparation for today's table. The first is found in the Gospel of Luke. In Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 29, it says this. These words are from Simeon, who has picked up Jesus physically, took him in his arms on the day of his dedication. So Jesus is a little over a month or so old. He says this, and Simeon took Jesus up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace, according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel. And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign which will be spoken against. Yes, a sword will pierce through your own soul also, that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. And then if you would, turn over with me to the Gospel of Matthew. And we're going to be looking in Matthew chapter 26. In Matthew chapter 26, I want to begin with verse 19 following. So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When the evening had come, he sat down with the 12. Now, as they were eating, he said, assuredly, I say to you, one of you will betray me. And they were exceedingly sorrowful, and each of them began to say to him, Lord, is it I? He answered and said, he is. He who dipped his hand with me in the dish will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes just as it is written of him. But woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had not been born. Then Judas, who betrayed him, answered and said, Rabbi, Is it I? And he said to him, you have said it. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. But I say to you that I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until the day that I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And then Jesus said to them, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. In the reading of those two passages of Scripture, there are some inescapable things. Inescapable things. In the outline that's in your bulletin, though there are many of them, and we could pick them and talk about them for a long time, I've chosen four. Jesus has an inescapable destiny. When Simeon held him in his arms, and Simeon was told and revealed to Simeon by the Holy Spirit that he would not die until he saw the Messiah, until he saw the Savior, the Christ. When he held that child in his arms, when he saw that, he said to Mary, this child is destined. Now in the context, he said this child is destined for the rising and falling of many in Israel. In fact, he tells Mary when he says, and we'll talk about this a little bit later in the sword, he says, a sword will pierce your soul also, and that he will be spoken against. Please, Christian believer, do not be surprised when the world hates you. Even if you're really good, and you're really neat, and you're really cool, and you're really kind, and you're really helpful. Because they hated Jesus first. Now, that may sound like a really discordant thing to say on Communion Sunday, and on the first Sunday of the year, what are you thinking, preacher? I'm thinking it's inescapable. There are people who will walk away from Jesus, walk away from His love, walk away from His ministry, walk away from His hanging on the cross, His being risen from the dead, and walk their own path, and walk their own way, even making their own religions, and they will be lost. Because they hate the gospel. Because the gospel's too easy. I got to do something to earn my salvation, right? Nah, it's a free gift from God. All you got to do is take it and make it yours. No, 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 you don't understand. I have got to do something. Can't. No, I have got to do something. Can't. Salvation is by grace and grace alone. Well, I want it my way. Can't have it your way. No, no, you don't understand. I want it my way. Sounds like, you know, fast food commercial. Can't have salvation your way. Only one way to have salvation. What's His name? What's His name? One more time. Without Him, there is no salvation. Destined. When Jesus came to John the Baptist to be baptized, He said that He was the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world, that He was destined to bear and carry our sins. Destined. Let me tell you something else that's destined. Do you know Jesus? you're destined for heaven. Oh, well, you know, Reverend, I don't know about... Look, through forgiveness, through becoming a new creation, being born again, by coming and receiving Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, God does a work in you that you then become destined not only to be a child of God, an heir of God, but eternity is your destiny. Without Jesus, hell is your destiny. Oh, that's just religion. Won't be religion when you're standing in front of him and he asks you, why should I let you in heaven? And you give him every answer you can think. Well, I wasn't as bad as Don Jones. Give me a break. What'd you do with my son, Jesus? He was destined as the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. He was destined to hang on that cross. He was destined to rise from the dead. He was destined to offer to you a destiny. Don't forget that in this year. Don't forget that today as we come to this table. Your destiny in Christ Jesus is inescapable. And your destiny outside of Jesus Christ is inescapable. Jesus' destiny, for the Word to become flesh and to dwell among us, to hang on that cross and say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do, to cry out, it is finished, be laid in that grave, dead, and on the third day rise again, his destiny to be at the right hand of the Father in high, in glory, his destiny to prepare an eternal place for those who believe in him, destiny, it's inescapable. Mary and Joseph were told that Jesus had a destiny. And I'm here today to share with you that if you know him as your Lord and Savior, guess who else has a destiny? Me. The second thing I want you to see is that when being spoken to, Simeon says to Mary and Joseph, Anna was there, and I'm sure by now there's a crowd. He says that Jesus will be a sign and will be spoken against. You and I realize, as I've shared with you, that the world and Jesus are not friends. Now, we can do a couple things. We can moan and we can whine about the fact that they don't treat us right and that we don't understand how they can walk away into some of the error that we find our culture and our world walking into. Because that's not what Jesus ever intended. But he said he is a sign. I want you to understand that Jesus Christ takes the opportunity to divide humanity. Any of you familiar with jazz music, Porgy and Bess? Anybody? Is you is or is you ain't my baby? Is you is or is you ain't Jesus's? Well, no, you don't understand. We're separated by economics. We're separated by ethnicity. We're separated by continents. We're separated by heritage. We're separated in all sorts of ways. No. When you come down to it, the separation is whether you're Jesus or whether you're not. I can't explain it any clearer than what Simeon said to Mary and Joseph. He's a sign. He's a sign. And he points to heaven. When I was a young believer, you know, one way. Remember that? One way. I had that on my little Volkswagen Beetle in a bumper sticker. I also had honk if you love Jesus, and I wonder why people honked at me. One way, Jesus. He is a sign. A sign of God's love. A sign of God's peace. A sign of God's destiny. A sign of God's grace. A sign that points you and points me to know Him and to love Him, to serve Him, and to live out our destiny in a relationship with Him. He's a sign. And I want you to understand that that sign you love Jesus, but know that not everybody else does. You want to love and follow Him, not everybody else does. It's a sign. Jesus told His disciples, I'm going to give you a sign. I'm going to spend, like the prophet Jonah, 3 days. He's going to be dead 3 days. He's going to give us another sign. We call them the elements of communion. He's going to give us bread. And He's going to give us a cup. He's going to give us bread that is broken and shared. A cup that represents His blood. Not everybody cherishes that sign. Not everybody cherishes that cross. Not everybody cherishes our Lord Jesus. But when you do, listen, when you do, man, you're His. And the people said, it's a sign. The other thing that He said to Mary on that day, that there was going to be a sword pierced through her soul. These words are exact for a reason. He was not saying that Mary was going to die by being thrust through with a sword in her body, but there would be the anguish and the pain and the agony in her soul. Because where was Mary on the day Jesus died on the cross? Watching Him. Watching the baby. She had announced by an angel, watching the baby laid in a manger, watching the shepherds, watching Simeon and Anna, watching the wise men, watching Him grow, seeing Him in the temple, awaiting that day where He entered ministry. And now she watched Him. That was her baby boy on that cross. That's why Simeon said to her, a sword will pierce your soul. Now, we know that's not the end of the story. She saw her son again, resurrected and glorified. And that changes and has changed everything. You know, you and I go through tragedy. When you and I go through difficulty. When you became a born-again, believing, living, loving like you love Jesus Christian, that did not insulate you from hurt. It did not insulate you from tragedy. It did not insulate you from the sin and its effect in this world, in and around you. Christians get cancer. Christians divorce. Christians lose loved ones. Christians can go broke. Christians, you know where I'm going? Each of those is a sword. Each of those touch our life at the very depths of our being. But you know, the sword touches more than the soul. It touches Jesus as well. He knows your infirmities. You've read this, haven't you? He knows who you are. He knows what you think. He even knows your attitude right now. He knows. He still loves me. He still loves you. And I want you to understand, I want you to come and know that those swords, they come. And they will. And there are times that our hearts can and do break. But he says that he is the balm in Gilead. He is the one who will heal us. I read that in Isaiah 53. By his stripes we are healed. Look for a moment. This sword is inescapable. Mary's not going to get out of this. He's going to die. That's why he came. When he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he sweated great drops of blood, when he says, "If it be your will, let this cup pass from me," he was not asking not to die. My opinion, he was asking not to be crucified. Because Jesus was a man, and it was going to hurt. There is no crueler thing that mankind has ever devised as capital punishment than a cross. People could linger for days on the cross. It's inescapable. But yet as inescapable as the sword is also the presence of the Lord who said, "The fire will not harm you. The flood will not overtake you." Pastor, you don't know what I'm going through. No, I don't. You don't know how deep and desperate I am. No, I don't. But I do know who the answer to is in every deep despair and in all desperation is one way. His name is Jesus. Here's the last thing. There comes a decision. It is inescapable. You're going to make a decision about whether or not you're going to live for Jesus or not. Whether you're going to accept and receive Him as your Lord and Savior or not. That decision is inescapable. Every once in a while, I would do youth camps. And when I would do youth camps, I would ask this question. How many of you kids have a grandmother praying for you? And a bunch of kids would raise their hand. I said, "Give up now. God answers grandma's prayers. Give up now." It is inescapable, the destiny of Jesus. It is inescapable, the destiny of you and I in faith. It is inescapable that He will be a sign. Inescapable. Inescapable that we will not be touched by the sword, but it is also inescapable that you and I will have to make a decision. Mary and Joseph had to give obedience to the Lord in the circumcision, in the dedication, in the rearing and bringing up of Jesus. Had to release Him. If you grew up in Fayette County, Pennsylvania, there's a store called Peachins. I can't describe Peachins. It'd take too long. Think with me of World War II Quonset huts with holes in the floor. But the thing about Peachins is the fact that they made the Wall Street Journal, in that they were a grocery store that made $14+ million a year. Profit. Quonset huts over a creek. You could look down. I tell you this because one day Pat and I were in the meat aisle, which was a whole different thing, and a lady wanted to hold our daughter. I did not know this lady who wanted to hold my daughter. I did not particularly want that lady to hold my daughter. Mary and Joseph gave Jesus to Simeon, and he said, "You have to make a decision, Mary and Joseph." handed him back. Anna prophesied over him. And today, and for every day for the rest of your life, you are going to make decisions about whether or not you will love him, whether or not you will follow him, whether or not you will serve him, whether or not you will do as he compels and calls you to do. Folks, that's inescapable. Now, of course, the whole point of the sermon is, what do I want? Quit trying to escape. Embrace, love, serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Choose this day who you will serve. You may even want to proclaim like Joshua did, for me and my house will serve the Lord. I want you to prepare your heart for this communion by realizing these things are inescapable. And I want to ask you to embrace him and to love him and to serve him and to obey him. Let me pray with you. Lord Jesus, we want to prepare our hearts to come to your table. You have ransomed and you have redeemed us. And today we celebrate that love in you. For I ask this in Jesus' name. And the people said, the Bible tells us on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body given for you. This is my body broken for you. This is my body, my life. And I want you to know me and to live in me. Lord Jesus, we will hold in our hands the emblem of your death. Thank you, Jesus. It was inescapable for you to be the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. And I thank you that I can, and that we can know you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The scripture tells us to do this in remembrance of me. Might we partake and might we remember together. Let's share. Jesus also took the cup after supper, saying, this is the new covenant, a new testament in my blood. In a sense, the culture tells us that on this New Year's Day, everything's brand new. That may be true on the calendar, but it is really the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ who makes us new. And we hold in his hands the emblem of that blood that washed us whiter than snow, that gave us that destiny. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you. Jesus said, this is a new covenant, a new testament. In reality, something truly wonderfully new in Him. Let's celebrate it together. Lord Jesus, the Bible tells us, as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we do show the Lord's death until He comes. Something else inescapable. You're coming back. And we await that day, whether we see You face to face or whether the trumpet sounds and the graves open. We come to celebrate You this day through and in the power of Jesus' name. And all the people said, Amen. Amen.